Okay, so I realized that we didn't really have much of an opportunity to look over many spectrograms during class today, and so I thought it would be helpful if we went through an actual spectrogram exercise and if I talked you through some of the ways in which I approach reading a spectrogram. And in this case, I thought we'd do an SPHR faculty edition. So the spectrogram that I show you is me reading the name of one of the faculty members here in SPHR, but I'm not going to tell you which one it is. You'll probably figure it out before we get to the end, but it'll be a bit of a mystery until then. So here's the spectrogram, and you can see that at the beginning, starting out from brand new spectrogram can be a bit daunting because it can be kind of hard to figure out where to start. So when I looked at this, I actually made this recording quite a while ago, and I didn't remember exactly what was represented here. So I had to figure it out myself right from the beginning today. So what I did is I started out by thinking, well, what comes first? And the first thing that I noticed is we've got a sound right here, and it's got a characteristic structure to it. And those look like formants to me. And so the first thing that I did is I mapped out the formants. And I looked at those two formants, and I thought, well, I've got an F1, it's right around 500 hertz, and I've got an F2, it's right around 2400 hertz. That's a fairly wide gap. That suggests that it's a vowel in the front part of the vowel space, but I'm not sure exactly where it is. That's okay. That's all I need to get out of that particular part of the spectrogram. Moving on to the next thing, one of the things that I notice is right next to that, there's something that's also very distinctive here. And that is an area where you see things that look like they're trying to be formants, but they aren't really getting to be very strong formants. And the way that I think about this is that those formants sort of look like crappy formants. And crappy formants tend to be characteristic of particular kinds of consonant sounds, sonorant sounds in general, with nasals and laterals being the main ones that have this kind of crappy formant. And you can see there's one formant there at about 500 hertz and another one maybe at about 1200, 1250 hertz or so. So that's a nice little landmark. Now the next sound that we have again goes back to having formants, and you can see that there's an F1 down there around 400 hertz or so. And F2 up there around 2500 hertz. So when you compare the first vowel we saw to the second vowel that we see, what I notice is F1 went down and F2 went up, which means that we're going up higher in the front part of the vowel space from this vowel here to this vowel here. Moving forward, what we see is that the next sound has two parts to it. The first part is silence. And the second part is a release of that silence, followed by a little bit of noisy energy that doesn't seem to have any vocal fold vibration going on down here. Now, as I look through all of that energy of the release, I notice that it's not all the same. It's relatively light down here, but if I look right here, I see a whole bunch of darkness right in that zone. Now, that zone starts at about 1500 hertz and it ends around 2500 hertz, so it's sort of centered right around 2000 hertz. And that's the accumulation of the energy of that particular burst. Just from looking at it, I can tell that it's a stop. And by measuring that band of energy between 1500 and 2500 hertz, I can tell that the center of that energy is right around 2000 hertz. And that's characteristic of a velar stop in most cases. Moving forward, the next thing we see is another little vowel, but notice how short this vowel is compared to these other two vowels. That makes me think that maybe this is kind of a reduced vowel. Perhaps this is an unstressed syllable. And we see that we've got a formant at around 500, maybe a little over 500 hertz, and another formant up at about 1700, 1800 hertz or so. And those are kind of in the mid ranges, both for F1 and for F2. The next sound we see has widely distributed energy. And what I notice is that the darkest energy is all the way up here at the top. And in fact, in particular, it's up above 4,000 hertz is where we really get into the darkness. There's an energy that distributes all the way through the spectrum, but it's a notable difference all the way up here at the top. And where I see energy that's centered around 4,000 hertz in a noisy sound, that's usually a good sign that what we're talking about is some kind of an alveolar fricative. So I'm thinking that this is an alveolar fricative coming up. The next sound after that, we have, again, silence followed by a sudden release. So I'm thinking that this is a stop, but this time I don't see that same kind of accumulation of energy that I saw here. There's no extra darkness right around here. And if anything, there's a little extra darkness up here. Now that, where you have that extra darkness centered in the higher frequencies up around 4,000 hertz, that's more characteristic of an alveolar stop. And you might notice that there's a consistency between the energy of the release of an alveolar stop, like t, and the energy that's accumulated for the alveolar fricative, something like s. And that's not a coincidence. That's a direct result of the fact that they're both made at alveolar places of articulation. Now, the next thing that we see after that stop is another vowel. We've got a first formant down here, maybe at about 600 hertz. Then we've got this second formant that's kind of has a trajectory that starts up higher and ends down lower. If we aim for a mid part of that, we don't know where it's coming from or where it's going, so it's hard to tell what the formant transitions are right now. But we may be able to say that there's a midpoint of that energy somewhere around 2,000 hertz or so for F2. So I labeled them as maybe 600 hertz and 1,900 hertz. That's at least an estimate, and that's good enough for right now. Now, this next sound that we're going to look at here, you'll notice again, crappy formants that look like they're trying to be a vowel but kind of failing. And that's characteristic of either a nasal or a lateral sound. And again, you'll notice there's a formant down low, something mid, and something a little bit higher. If you look higher, you could probably identify some other sort of crappy looking formants. The exact location of these doesn't give you a whole lot of information, but knowing that they're not very good formants tells you that this is some kind of a sonorant consonant. The next sound that we have, as I look at it, I notice a lot of similarity between this sound and that sound in that there's a lot of noisy energy. And there's an accumulation of that noisy energy up here around the 4,000 hertz area. And I notice one thing that looks a little different between this sound, which we think is an alveolar fricative, and this sound, which we think is an alveolar fricative. And that's down here. Down here, what I notice is there's a little bit of evidence that there might be vocal fold vibration going on. Some of these striations seem to be coming through here, and that looks a little bit different than the noise that's accumulating down here. This does not look like vocal fold vibration, where this looks like it might be vocal fold vibration. So now I'm wondering if this isn't a voiced alveolar fricative. So those are my hypotheses. The next thing that I'll look at here is another vowel, and notice how this is a nice short vowel. You got two formants that you can identify. They may make you think of these two formants. They're pretty similar, and in fact, it's that short vowel again. Again, I may be thinking of this as another reduced vowel. The next sound looks very noisy. Maybe not too surprising at this point, but you'll notice that the darkest area, the accumulation of energy, is up here in the 4,000 hertz range. So it looks like this name is a name that might have three different alveolar fricatives in it. The following sound, what we see are these crappy formants again, looking a little bit like this sound, looking a little bit like this sound. So we're thinking that this is a sonorant consonant, this is a sonorant consonant, and this is probably also a sonorant consonant. And no big surprise what's coming up next. We've got a vowel. Very clear F1, very clear F2. There's a little bit of transition that you notice. So it may be hard to tell exactly what the formant value is. But you can tell that it's a good strong formant trajectory. And then finally, there's this here. Now, it's clearly noisy. It's not a periodic sound. It doesn't look like it's got any kind of vocal fold vibration. And the noise is distributed in a particular way. It's very even from the top of the frequency spectrum down to the lowest parts where we see much noise being represented. There's no real accumulation of energy. And where we see that kind of wide distribution of fricative energy, of noisy energy, we tend to think of this as almost certainly a non-sibilant fricative. And non-sibilant fricatives would be things like f or th or sometimes h. But really, the idea of h is not very likely because there just aren't any words in English or any names that I'm aware of that end with the sound h. So I'm thinking this is either a f or a th sound here at the end of this word. Now, whose name is this? We've got a whole bunch of evidence here, but exactly what sound is going on, I'm not sure that I know, except I'm going to suspect that this is actually a k sound. I think it's a velar stop, and it's clearly a voiceless velar, a voiceless stop. And here I'm thinking that this might be t. Here I'm thinking that this is s. I'm thinking this might be z because it's a voiced alveolar fricative. And here's another s sound. So I've got a few of the sounds, and I can start thinking, well, whose name corresponds to this? So here's a little list of the different faculty members in the SPHR department. I've included Elsa Nelson, who is not currently down in the basement of Neuberger, but she was on the faculty when I made this spectrogram, so she was in the mix. And as I look through the things that I'm going to think of, I want a name that begins with a vowel, then has a sonorant consonant, and then has another vowel. And ideally, they would be two vowels in the front part of the vowel space, with this one being just a little bit lower than this one, which would be a little bit higher, but both in the front vowel space. I would want something that has a velar stop and a few different alveolar fricatives, one of which I think may be voiced. And as I look through these names, there's one name that really kind of stands out. Now, I'm not going to say that name here. Oh, the other thing I should say, actually, before I sign off, the other thing I should say is this here is actually a pretty good acoustic signature. The idea that this may be the last sound in the name and that it's probably not an alveolar fricative, because if it were an alveolar fricative, we would see an accumulation of energy up here, which we don't see. So this is probably a non-sibilant fricative, something like a f or a th. Now, it turns out there's only one name that ends that way. So, in fact, the answer to this ends up being reasonably easy. But the process of going through and identifying every single sound can be very helpful in preparing for doing the kind of spectrogram reading that you'll likely have to do as a part of the exam that's coming up. So what I'd like to do is return you to the spectrogram with no annotations on it, and just suggest that you go through from start to finish and see if you can work out exactly which sound is going on at exactly which points in this spectrogram, and see if you come up with the same answer that I did. Thanks very much for watching, and enjoy your spectrography.